simple additions. Four delegations who will be invited forward in the following order: Mr. Doug Bryden, Mr. Hirsch Gandhi, Mr. Steve Rhodes, and Mr. Garnet Manning, speaking to the report I-2-1, which we'll bring forward and have a presentation prior to the delegations. And correspondence, two pieces of correspondence identified as L-1, associated with report item I-8-3. Councillor Palaszczuk.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. There is one item that's on the agenda, which is J-3. I'd like to actually refer that to February 23rd. Reason being is we dealt with that at planning. It's concerning some development on Bramley Road. And because we want to make sure that all of the residents are notified, it was kind of short notice running between Monday and then today. So I'm asking that that item be referred so that we can give the minutes, sorry, of that meeting so that we can give them proper notification. So moving it to February 23rd, please.
So that's under
J3, the planning. Yeah. Planning
J3,
minutes.
J3, that particular minutes will go to Feb 23?
Yes, please.
Okay, that will add that right to the agenda. Any other questions or comments? All those in favor of the agenda as amended, thank you. Mr. Clerk, I'll leave you to add the correct refer, defer words for J3 so that that is properly included. The next item on the agenda, conflicts of interest. This is the time for conflicts of interest to be declared. Seeing none, we move to the minutes of the January 26th meeting. They are moved by Councillor Sanderson, seconded by Councillor Callahan. All those in favor of the minutes as printed. Thank you. That endorses all those actions. Council, we now move to the consent resolution. The consent resolution combines a number of decisions that are being recommended today that have been previously discussed at appropriate committees or have reached the point of decision and can be considered to be, when we vote for this motion, these decisions are considered carried collectively without individual debate. But if any member of council wishes to pull any item out for further debate today, this is the time we would do that. Seeing no comments to the board, are there any items to add into consent? Perhaps I-2-1. Oh, just kidding. All those in favor of the consent motion as stated? Thank you. That is carried. Thank you. We now move to announcements. Announcements are, there are two announcements today. And the first announcement, I'd like to invite Steve Colley here to come and address us. He is a member of our Brampton Heritage Board, and he would like to make an exciting announcement. Welcome, Steve.
Thank you, Mayor. Thank you, Council. The announcement I'd like to make today is our fourth annual Highlights on Heritage Show. And we're having that at the Bramley City Center on this Saturday, just before Valentine's. And the Highlights on Heritage started 4 years ago with about three groups and about four tables. Now we have seven groups and we have 12 tables. And the Bramley City Center, or Morgott Investments, have actually donated a space in the Bay Court for us, free of charge. It's a huge spot where we can set up our displays. And the groups out this year are the Brampton Heritage Board, the Brampton Historic Society, we have Beauvert House, we have a group called PAN, the Peel Aboriginal Network, we have the Britannia Schoolhouse coming up, we have the Caledon Heritage Society, and we have the Peel Heritage Complex. We'll all have displays and interactive displays to work with children, to work with people. And the nice thing about this show is that the mall attracts close to about 70,000 people on that weekend. They have counters there, so we know what kind of attendance we get. And what we're getting is we're getting a lot of new people, a lot of newcomers to the city. And then some of the benefits I found personally have been when I have people say to me, we're just new to the city, but our children are born here, and we're glad that we're able to learn something about the history of the city here. So that's this Saturday from 9 till 6. And I invite the mayor and all members of council, if you're by, please drop by and say hi. We'll all be in costumes and outfits there. Thank you, Mayor.
Thank you. Don't go away. Councillor Hutton.
Thank you, Steve, for, as always, being overly enthusiastic about and that's a good thing about Heritage. You've spread the gospel. You do the walking tours in downtown Brampton in costume as well. You've been appeared many times in period costume. So this is a really great event because, as I said, it's hands-on. It brings in the young people. And there's also information about Alderley and the restoration about Alderley that's taking, that'll be available as well. So it's just a great way to spread Heritage to the young people that are our future. And as Charlie Farquharson said, there's no future without a pasture, if I can quote the great philosopher. Anyway, keep spreading the gospel. You're doing a great job, and we really appreciate it on behalf of the Heritage Board. So
thank you very much.
Thank you, Steve. And Heritage is alive and well in the city of Brampton. I know you're up to date on the progress at Alderley as well. So for a modern city, we're taking the time, and I appreciate what you said about so many new people in Brampton are very, very keen to understand the roots and heritage of their new home. Absolutely. Thank you for that.
I can just mention one thing. The city also has did a good job with the CPR station, which we've been pushing for years, and now it's almost open. It's in part of the Mount Pleasant complex up there, and we'll show some advancement of what the city has done for us on that. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you. The second announcement, Dave DeForest, a member of our staff, is to come forward, and Wendy Hunter to tell us an announcement.
Thank you, Madam Mayor and members of council, senior management team, staff, and members of the public. The Council and Administrative Services Division of the Corporate Services Department is pleased and proud to announce the appointment of David DeForest, Multilingual Services Project Coordinator, as a 2011 DiverseCity Fellow. DiverseCity, a joint project of Greater Toronto Civic Action Alliance and the Maytree Foundation, is a collective effort to diversify leadership to help the GTA better achieve, excel, and prosper. The project acknowledges that the GTA requires leaders who have a diversity of skills and experience that reflects the richness and complexity of the region. A more diverse leadership will create a social and economic strategy for success in an increasingly interconnected world, access new global and domestic markets, build on the best ideas from home and abroad, attract and retain talent, engage more people in generating shared solutions, and reflect our Canadian values both at home and to the world. The project is working to change the face of GTA leadership through initiatives created to expand networks, strengthen institutions, advance knowledge, and track progress. DiverseCity Fellows is a one-year action-oriented leadership development program for rising city builders. The program is designed to support city builders who are deeply committed to enhancing their leadership abilities and practicing collective leadership to address issues that are critical to the future health and wealth of the Toronto region. The Fellows program consists of four integrated streams of activities: interactive learning sessions, network connections, a mentoring relationship, and city building projects. One of David's first activities as a DiverseCity Fellow is active participation in the Civic Action Greater Toronto Summit, taking place this Thursday and Friday at Metro Toronto Convention Centre. Thank you for your time, and David and I would welcome any questions you may have about DiverseCity and David's fellowship.
Well, thank you very much. Congratulations. Did you want to say a few words?
Well, Madam Mayor, I'd just like to say thanks for the opportunity, and I'm hoping that we can leverage this opportunity to make improvements here in Brampton and to promote Brampton when we're speaking at forums that involve the entire region.
Very good. Thank you. Thank you. Council, we now move to proclamations. Today we have two. Councillor Pleshey, you have the proclamation for Scout Guide Week.
Yeah, thanks, Madam Mayor. Whereas the mission of Scouts and Guides is to educate young people through a value system based on their promise and law, and whereas Girl Guides of Canada and Boy Scouts of Canada help build a better world where people are self-fulfilled as individuals and play a constructive role in society, and whereas 2011 marks 104 years of helping boys and girls become better citizens, therefore I, Councillor Paul Pleshey, on behalf of Mayor Susan Fennell, do hereby proclaim the week of February 20th to the 27th, 2011, to be
the Scout Guide Week in the City of Brampton.
Thank you very much. We could see that somebody gets that.
Actually, I can go, I'm going to their banquet. I can bring it.
You're going to the banquet? So you can take it.
I have to speak at their banquet, so I can bring it.
Oh, very nice. Okay, we'll leave it with you. The second proclamation, Council, if I could ask Councillor Callahan and Jocelyn Gardner, who is the president of the Canadian CAPS Network, if you could come forward to accept the proclamation.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Whereas there are more than 6,000 different rare disorders affecting up to 3 million Canadians, and whereas the Canadian Organization for Rare Disorders will join Rare Diseases, Europe, and many other countries to recognize International Rare Disease Day, and whereas this year's motto is Rare but Equal, and aims to raise awareness of rare diseases and the impact they have on patients' lives, and whereas by raising awareness for International Rare Disease Day, provides hope and information to affected patients and encourages collaboration to help the fight against rare diseases. Therefore, I, Bob Callahan, on behalf of Mayor Susan Fennell, do hereby proclaim February 28, 2001 as International Rare Disease Day in the City of Brampton, the stated 9th day of February 2011.
City of Brampton for recognizing Rare Disease Day and people in your community. It's very important for us to realize that we are your neighbors. Thank you.
You're our family. Thank you. Council, we now move to delegations, and prior to delegations, I think it would be appropriate to bring forward report I-2-1. I think that was done as part of the agenda. I would like to ask that the City Manager introduced the report. It is the City Manager's report as directed by Council. And then I have a motion here, and then I know the delegations. I think we have four delegations who want to speak to the report. So likely I would say the presentation would be helpful. Do you want to present from here or there? Where would you like to present?
Through you, Madam Mayor, if you don't mind, I'll move to the delegation area so that I can see all members of Council.
Thank you.
Thank you. It is my pleasure to be reporting back to Council as directed in December of 2010. You'll see the package in front of you. We are going to focus the presentation this afternoon on the proposed code of conduct for members of Council and to talk about the retention of an integrity commissioner on an interim basis, to talk to you about the preliminary budget for consideration in the 2011 budget, and to talk to you a little bit about the updated expense policy for the mayor and members of council. Some of you will have seen today a story in our local Brampton Guardian where it was referenced that the city manager had been given 100 days to approach and to complete this task, and the Guardian said that that had been done in 56. Well, if you take out the weekends, I think it's actually something like 39, but given that the staff team did in fact work most weekends, I think we'll stick with the 56 days. So in approaching this task, first and foremost was the recognition that the city has tremendous professional experts across the corporation who could provide assistance and to help undertake this research and benchmarking exercise. I established a cross-department team that included Mo Lewis, our Commissioner of Finance and City Treasurer, Kathy Zammit, our Commissioner of Corporate Services, Colin Grant, our city solicitor, Catherine Spence, our city auditor, Peter Fay, our city clerk, Deborah Reeder in the office of the city manager, and Olga Lukic, also in the office of the city manager. We began by conducting the research and benchmarking exercise to ensure that we had the most up-to-date and useful information as it related to what the municipal sector has been doing with respect to codes of conduct and appointments of integrity commissioners. Of the 445 Ontario municipalities, we have been able to confirm that less than 10 have a code of conduct for elected officials and have appointed an integrity commissioner. The most notable examples that will be familiar, I expect, to members of council and to members of the public that are joining us today are the cases of the City of Toronto and the City of Mississauga. It is also worth noting that in both of those instances, the appointment of an integrity commissioner was in respect to a particular incident. In Toronto, it was as a result of the Bellamy inquiry, and in the City of Mississauga, it is about the conduct and operations related to the Mayor McCallion and the issues related to her family members. So, in developing the code of conduct, first and foremost, and this is, I'm sure, a refresher for all members of council, we have assembled for you in a binder all of the legislative references that are applicable to elected officials, and they are quite extensive and are those that bind and shape municipal elected official conduct and behavior. And you can see the list here in front of you. I know that most of these things are backdrops to the way that you operate. They are, of course, complemented by our own City of Brampton policies, bylaws, and protocols. We have assembled the binder for you, Madam Mayor and members of council, so that you can have in one spot the pieces of legislation that are already the rules that guide municipal conduct. I also, Earl, if I could ask for your assistance, please, our deputy clerk is going to hand out for you a new consolidated version, which is the interpretation of the Municipal Act and the Freedom of Information Protection Act and the Municipal Conflict of Interest Act. And you can see by the weight and scope that, again, this is an illustration of the number of rules that currently guide the conduct of elected officials. I'll just wait for you to be finished, Mr. Deputy.
We're going to pause and read this now. We'll be back to you in a minute.
So, in consideration, as every council that introduces a code of conduct or contemplates introducing a code of conduct, first and foremost needs to decide on which is going to be most effective and what is going to fit the circumstances of the local community. The debate tends to center on whether a values-based or a rules-based approach to the code of conduct is most suitable. A rules-based approach, generally speaking, establishes rigid boundaries for conduct and does attempt to prescribe the do's and don'ts of municipal elected official behavior and conduct. It also, of course, requires compliance with the letter of the law as it is written. In communities that have adopted a rules-based approach, it tends to be those communities who are trying to provide some kind of remedy or to address a particular situation that has emerged in their council. A prescriptive code of conduct, then, is introduced as a way to instruct and to guide elected officials on what they can and cannot do. A values-based approach, on the other hand, uses principles and standards to guide behavior and it complements existing laws and policies. And you can see from your 3-inch ring binder and the consolidated legislative tool and handbook that was just given out to you, we aren't without rules in the municipal sector. A value-based approach in developing a code of conduct also allows elected officials to apply their judgment on a daily basis when exercising their responsibilities. It also avoids having to prescribe or detail every single conceivable interaction an elected official might have. So if you adopt a rules-based approach, you end up with an attempt at developing a very exhaustive list. And inevitably, you will come up against a situation that hasn't been contemplated, and because it's not in your code of conduct, would fail to provide guidance to that elected official. A values-based approach, on the other hand, that is used as a complement, of course, to all of the rules and regulation and laws that already bind your behavior, can be used as a guide and a way to empower and build upon your best judgment. It is also worth noting that in the municipal inquiry underway in the city of Mississauga, an expert panel, including the former Integrity Commissioner for the City of Toronto, David Mullen, has concluded that a value-based approach is preferred to developing a code of conduct. And the experts, those that spend their time thinking about these things from a policy perspective, consider that a value-based approach actually does more to build the public trust. And it's a better way for you to exercise your role and responsibility as a trustee of the public confidence. Based on our review, we are recommending a values-based approach for a Made in Brampton Code of Conduct. The code incorporates the distinct legislated role for the councillors and for the mayor as the head of council. It also, in adopting a values-based approach, is based on the understanding that members of council are aware of and understand the statutory obligations imposed on council as a whole and on you as an individual member. The principles that we have identified in the code of conduct are areas that we believe are important areas of public trust that reflect the interest and expectations of the public. These include conduct respecting measures to achieve transparent, accountable, and good governance, the use of corporate resources, and the treatment of gifts, hospitality, and benefits. In terms of the conduct for transparent, accountable, and good governance, there are three areas of focus that we would like to touch briefly on. One is the conduct for council and committee meetings. The second is the conduct of elected officials with respect to staff. And the third is the conduct of elected officials with respect to holding confidential information. The way that you will see the presentation has been organized, we have tried to put into this one slide for you the areas that are identified in the code of conduct. So as it relates for conduct for council and committee meetings, it would entail an agreement from members of council to use respectful language and behavior. It is an agreement to consider the diverse opinions of your colleagues and those that come to this chamber. It is an agreement to treat all persons with dignity and respect in an environment free of discrimination and harassment, with special attention to the Ontario Human Rights Code, the Occupational Health and Safety Act, and our city's own workplace harassment prevention policy. Adherence to our procedure bylaw is often and is probably the easiest for members of council. Because as seasoned elected officials who have served many terms, you are aware of what you're supposed to do in a council and committee meeting. It is, of course, in the interest of spirited debate that sometimes the conduct in the council or committee meeting can sometimes become emotionally charged. So the code of conduct is simply a reminder that we will do as we did, as Commissioner Zammit said, as we learned in kindergarten, and that was to play nicely. With respect to the conduct respecting staff, members of council would agree that staff members serve council as a whole under the direction of the city manager. And there would be agreement that staff members will establish the appropriate policies, systems, processes, and internal controls to implement the decisions of council. And third is the agreement that staff members will provide advice to council free from influence from any member of council or any faction of council, and will provide advice based on political neutrality and professional advice. And these, of course, are going to be self-evident, and this is, again, a reminder. Conduct respecting confidential information, again, is the agreement that you have a responsibility as members of council to safeguard the corporation's interest and reputation and to uphold confidentiality and disclosure rules. It is also that you would agree to respect the confidentiality requirements for information you might receive or be in possession of in a closed session of council. And last but not least is the agreement that as members of council, you will respect the confidentiality and disclosure rules as prescribed and administered by the city clerk under the Municipal Freedom of Information and Protection of Privacy Act. The second area to concentrate on is conduct respecting the use of corporate resources. And there are four subheadings here listed for you in the Code of Conduct. First is as it relates to charitable activities. The second is as it relates to office budgets and resources supporting community activities. Third is the use and commitment of city resources. And the fourth is the conduct respecting election campaigns. Members of council serve their community in a variety of ways. It is accepted and I believe recognized that the work that you do in the community is vitally important and in fact contributes to the overall vitality and health of our community. It's probably worth noting and reiterating, although again I'm sure this is a refresher for members of council, that the Municipal Act specifically says that Mayor Fennell has additional duties in this regard, that the mayor is to promote public involvement in municipal activities, to act as the representative of the municipality, both within and outside the municipality, locally, nationally, and internationally, and to participate in and foster activities that enhance the economic, social, and environmental well-being of the municipality and its residents. This section of the Code of Conduct has been written with that appreciation that each one of you performs vitally important community service. So the Code of Conduct would have an agreement that members of council are community leaders who assist and support charities, service clubs, and not-for-profit community-based organizations in a variety of ways. And there are some listed here for you, but of course these are not exhaustive. It can be that you accept an honorary role. It could be that you lend your name to an organization or event to assist in fundraising. It could be that you encourage community donations to registered charitable, not-for-profit, or other community-based groups. And it concludes with the understanding and agreement that when you are supporting community activities, it still requires transparency with respect to your role and with respect to your involvement. We have also provided additional detail with respect to office budgets and the allocation that you are given on a term basis. Members of council will know that subject to budget approval, you are given an allocation and you are free to use that in what is the exercise of your responsibilities and to use your judgment to do so. The Code of Conduct says in this regard that you will respect and uphold the city's policies that guide the members' use of city office budgets and resources in support of community activities. We have, rather than what some municipalities have done, and that is to embed an expense policy right into a code of conduct, as an alternative, we have updated and refreshed the policies, expense policies for the mayor and members of council, and those are attached, Mayor Fennell and members of council, to the council report before you and are recommended for approval today. The expense policy is intended to provide guidance related to office, business, and to travel expenses, and it encompasses and replaces previous policies. The revised mayor and councillors' expense policy reinforces the city's continued commitment to provide the highest standard of public accountability while using public resources. With respect to the conduct of elected officials in the assignment and commitment of city resources, again, it's the statement that agreement that the powers of the municipality are exercised by council as a whole. And that, of course, comes directly from the Municipal Act. There's also a provision that members of council will agree that items or tasks or actions that require the commitment of significant time or city resources will first be approved by either committee or council. And that, members of council, Madam Mayor, is intended to ensure that the business of the corporation is going to be advanced in a methodical and comprehensive way, and that we ensure as a staff team that we are serving the interests of all of council. That, of course, does not mean that where you have individual requests related to a service or item or particular issue in your ward, of course, those things go without saying that we, of course, will provide assistance. But if you have a task or an action that would involve and is of interest on a citywide, corporate-wide basis, then respectfully, we're suggesting in the code of conduct that that would need to come through committee or council for approval first. Number 15 is a bit of a refresher for you. It is the understanding that while serving as a member of council during a municipal election, many of you will choose to be a candidate as well. And it is specifically listed in the code that you agree to uphold the Municipal Elections Act and all applicable legislation while acting as a candidate while continuing to fulfill your role as a member of council. There is also agreement that members' election campaigns are prohibited from using corporate resources, both real property and staff, to avoid the perception that the city has provided an advantage to a member of council over other candidates. And finally, it is the agreement that the city clerk will manage the municipal election process, ensuring that all candidates are treated equally and similarly. Third section in the code of conduct is respecting gifts, hospitality, and benefits. And this is one where I know that members of council often struggle, understanding that in the day-to-day course of your job, you will, because of activities of protocol or social obligation, often in good faith be asked to accept a gift, a hospitality, and a measure of an organization's esteem that they hold you in. In recognition of that, the code of conduct says and agrees that gifts, hospitality, or benefits of nominal value are part of your role as a member of council and are received in good faith by you and you alone as a form of protocol or social obligation. It also, again, to reaffirm that our goal is to achieve the highest ethical standards here in our code of conduct. It's an agreement that gifts and benefits received are a matter of public record and subject to disclosure. And in the code of conduct, there is a recommendation that members of council keep track and list the items that you might have received in your day-to-day activities and to be prepared to disclose those as a matter of public record. In terms of compliance and interpretation, the code says that should council today exercise its discretion and appoint an interim integrity commissioner, which we'll get to in a moment, this code of conduct and all applicable legislation, so the binder and the annotated act, three acts that have just been distributed to you, will serve as the foundation documents for the purposes outlined in the legislation. It's also important to note here that the code of conduct is a standalone document, and it is a living document, and it is subject to update and refresh as the legislation changes and as the expectations of members of the public might change. So that is the code of conduct. Should members of council agree and approve the code of conduct today, then it serves as the foundation for council to appoint an integrity commissioner. It is important to note here that, again, the the recommendation of staff and the acknowledgement of staff is that we are trying to strengthen and complement the existing legislation, rules, and policies that already exist and are recommending consideration of an office of the Integrity Commissioner on an interim basis for a period of up to 1 year. The Office of the Integrity Commissioner provides, in an independent manner, multiple services, including advice and education. The Integrity Commissioner serves as an advisor to Council with respect to your obligations under the Code of Conduct and the application of other policies and procedures that guide the ethical behavior of members of Council. The Integrity Commissioner also is responsible for investigating complaints received from individuals who believe that the Code of Conduct has been breached. I would add that although the Integrity Commissioner can be and would serve as a trusted advisor to a member of Council, they do not provide independent legal advice. Members of Council who would desire or feel the need to do so would still be counseled to do so. Establishing the Office of the Integrity Commissioner would mean that we would be having someone responsible for receiving, assessing, and where appropriate, investigating complaints. The Integrity Commissioner would independently determine whether and how an investigation would be conducted. And if a breach of the Code of Conduct is confirmed, penalties under the legislation include a reprimand or suspension of remuneration paid to that member of council for a period of up to 90 days. And that is prescribed in the legislation. We expect that the Integrity Commissioner would want to adopt a complaints protocol for receiving complaints. When we were doing our investigation, most municipalities have retained the services of an individual. In our estimation and recommendation, what is really needed is a comprehensive continuum of service that provides maximum trust and accountability to members of the public that complaints that they have are going to be handled in a careful and expeditious manner. We believe that the development of an office of the Integrity Commissioner, as opposed to a sole Integrity Commissioner performing that role, would be desirable to complement what the city already has in place in terms of our public complaints process. After careful consideration and after benchmarking, we are recommending that ADR Chambers serve as the city's interim Office of the Integrity Commissioner. ADR chambers and some of their services that they provide are documented for you in your council report. They are an internationally recognized firm that provides alternate dispute resolution mechanisms and resolutions. They are world-renowned and highly used by lawyers, professionals, by the courts to bring people together where there are disputes. The ADR Chambers currently has offices across Canada. There is one in Toronto, and they have a number of services that would be of potential benefit to our city. First is to provide the services of no less than a former judge who would serve as the interim integrity commissioner and be accountable directly to this council. Second, a lawyer called to the Bar of Ontario who would report to the integrity commissioner and who would be trained to consider the nature of the complaint, whether the complaint could be resolved informally or perhaps through existing channels here at the city, or whether the investigation or complaint was of such a serious nature that the integrity commissioner was in fact required. And last would be an administrative assistant reporting to the integrity commissioner, providing valuable intake and customer service to members of the public. So if I could pause for a moment and just give you an illustration. If a member of the public had a complaint about their snow removal, and they went onto the city's website and thought perhaps that the integrity commissioner might be the place to lodge that complaint, ADR Chambers would take and listen to that person's complaint and wouldn't say to them, "That's not what we do." They would take the person's name and phone number, and we would establish a mechanism for that, for them to simply redirect that back to the city, to our call center, to our works department, to be able to resolve the situation immediately. So it would be invisible and seamless to the member of the public. They simply would know that their complaint had been dealt with. On a more serious issue, if there was, for instance, a complaint that involved a human resources matter, an occupational health and safety, or a workplace harassment matter, we already have complaints procedures and investigation protocols here in the city for human resource complaints. The lawyer and integrity commissioner might conclude that that is appropriately handled here at the city and doesn't require their services. What we would be retaining by using ADR Chambers is we would be getting the best, the brightest, impartial, neutral assistance to our city. With this team approach, we also can ensure that an appropriate balance is going to be struck. And the appropriate balance is really our accountability to taxpayers, to be able to say that the Office of the Integrity Commissioner is providing a value, an added service to what the city already has in place, but that we are not going to be spending funds unnecessarily on something that the city can appropriately handle. ADR Chambers would provide services to the City of Brampton on an as-needed fee-for-service basis for that interim period of up to 1 year. Members of Council, the current budget estimate, which you will see next week in your budget binder, is $150,000, which represents the sliding scale of fees for the Office of the Integrity Commissioner and encompasses that three separate functions: the role of the administrative assistant and the intake function, the role of the lawyer to try to mediate and resolve issues informally, and third, the integrity commissioner. The actual costs for service provision are, of course, very, very difficult to predict. And the legislation is very open-ended. And as members of council who are striving to achieve all of the best and to be centers of excellence in terms of open, transparent, ethical conduct, you don't want a budget cap and can't impose a budget cap. So this is a best estimate based on what our benchmarking has revealed from other municipalities and what we believe is a reasonable first-year allocation. The actual cost for service provision would form part of the report back to council after that first year. In terms of the individuals that ADR Chambers is recommending serve the city of Brampton, I will not go through the Honorable Donald Cameron's CV. It is attached here for you. This is an eminently qualified former Superior Court Justice who is very distinguished in his field. What is of most interest to us and the value of ADR Chambers is that should the Honorable Justice Cameron decide that he's going to take a week's vacation, there are other justices on the panel at ADR Chambers that would be able to fill in, and they are some distinguished names, including the Honorable Roy McMurtry, the former Chief Justice of Ontario. So again, this is, with no pun intended, a lot of bench strength. Sorry. Also, the lawyer to provide assistance to us is a gentleman by the name of Ted McDermott, who is consistently named as one of Canada's top 500 lawyers. He is extremely distinguished and has performed an ombudsman-type function for many organizations. And you'll know, of course, that the role of an ombudsman is to resolve complaints. So again, someone eminently qualified to assist. And of course, Mr. McDermott would be assisted by a number of other lawyers as needed. In terms of next steps, Madam Mayor and members of council, I won't go through all of the recommendations that are listed in the report. It is recommended that council approve the code of conduct as presented today, taking into consideration that it is a principle-based document that can be amended at any time and is a complement to the existing rules, practices, policy, and legislation currently in place that guides your day-to-day conduct. We have recommended a 30-day consultation period in order to gather public input on the code of conduct, and will of course report back with recommended amendments to the code of conduct if necessary based on that feedback. Following that, and I must say as well on the feedback, just as a note, immediately after council, subject of course to the approval of council today, we have put a special place on the city's website where members of the public can log on and can express in written form what their thoughts are. There's also a telephone number for them to call. There is an opportunity as well for them to submit written submissions. And of course, I would do my best to answer and to speak with members of the public as I can. Following that 30-day consultation period to ensure that we have the code of conduct that is approved for council, it is recommended that the city manager be authorized to execute the retainer agreement with ADR Chambers to provide our integrity commissioner services on an interim basis for a period of up to 1 year. And next week you will see that committee of council will consider the budget allocation of $150,000 to establish the office of the integrity commissioner. In closing, introducing and considering a code of conduct along with the establishment of the office of the integrity commissioner are additional means for members of council to underscore your commitment to achieve the highest standard of conduct and ethical behavior while serving the citizens of Brampton. Thank you, Mayor Fennell. Thank you, members of council.
Thank you very much. Just before you go away, there are questions, there are requests to speak, and we have four delegations. So, hear the delegations before questions. Deborah's not going to be far. So does that sound fair? Councillor Sprovir and Councillor Miles, you were down for questions. Can we hear the delegations first? Okay.
Yes, Mayor Fennell?
Come and join us. Then we're going to, do we have the list of delegations here, so we take them over. Thank you very much to the city manager for this introduction and this report. And just so council knows, the recommendation contained in the report is before the chair, before the mayor. It is moved by myself and seconded by Councillor Pelleche. This is an important day for Brampton. As you know, traditionally, certainly since I've been mayor, at the beginning of every term, we pass a similar motion to update all of our legislative rules and procedures that deal with accountability and transparency. And as we begin this term, we are doing the same thing in the spirit of the new legislation that was provided for in the Municipal Act last term, where council unanimously decided at that time that the rules and procedures in place did not, council unanimously supported the recommendation to not proceed with establishing an office of an integrity commissioner. That was a unanimous decision of this council. You're all returned, so you're all part of that decision. And today, we have a recommendation to establish an office of an integrity commissioner in the spirit of moving forward with an updated code of conduct, an updated expense policy. I'm very pleased with the 30-day public consultation and the way that has been handled. I would like to invite Mr. Doug Bryden, if you would join us, please, followed by Mr. Hirsch Gandhi. Where's Hirsch? Where'd he go? Oh, and then Mr. Steve Rhodes, is he coming? Okay, just so you know your order then, Mr. Manning. Welcome, Mr. Bryden.
Thank you, Madam Mayor and councillors. I would like to first congratulate you, Deborah. I think you've put together quite an exhaustive and complete report, and it was timely, which I think we all encourage. But it's not quite, and that's why I'm here. I've got one or two comments that I wanted to make. Firstly, I would take issue with the statement on page 7 of your report that says, and I quote, "Every council that introduces a code of conduct must decide whether a rules-based regime or a values-based reference is most suited to their community." In my opinion, it is not an either-or decision for any community. Both are appropriate and can and should be applied as appropriate to suit any given situation. Particularly, councillors have to be aware of right versus wrong decisions and the consequences. For instance, there are rules of conflict of interest situations which are rarely subject to interpretation. They are a matter established norms and legislation. But there are situations which arise and present council with a dilemma, an ethical dilemma, a right versus right decision. And in these instances, decisions based on shared common values are more appropriate. Most of the time, they will fit into the following categories: truth versus loyalty, short-term versus long-term, justice versus mercy, and self versus the community. These decisions, difficult as they may be, can get more easily made by applying the following guides and weighing the most suitable. Firstly, ends-based, what is the greatest good for the greatest number? Rule-based, is this a suitable rule for everyone to follow in similar situations? And of course, care-based, which is the golden rule. Therefore, the code of conduct, I prefer, of course, to call it the code of ethics, must outline standards of acceptable ethical conduct as well as reflect established behavioral rules as set down. Assuming that elected officials already know the rules is not an appropriate or relevant assumption on which to base the code, as experience elsewhere has shown. Two, in reading through the report, there is a lack of consistency in the use of the word ethical. In my view, it should precede the use of the word conduct in every instance. Additionally, there needs to be a definition of the word ethics so that everyone completely understands the meaning. 3. At the top of page 9, I believe that, quote, advice and education section, the words upon their request need to be removed in each bullet so that the obligations and responsibilities of counsel and potential exposures to counsel are clearly stated by the integrity commissioner before decisions are made. 4. The qualifications of ADR